Alan will be looking north for Trevor. It's due south with the analysis. But now the action. Spurs against Arsenal. A dull, boring defensive fixture. They have been, but not this one. A hugely entertaining match watched by John Motson.
There's a hero's welcome from the Tottenham majority in the 33,000 sellout crowd for Teddy Sheringham, who was prostrate after taking a knock in the England game. And being a Londoner himself, he wouldn't have wanted to miss this derby. But one man who does is Spurs' Clive Wilson, injured in training. So Sol Campbell switches to left back, and there's a recall for Colin Calderwood, who this week helped Scotland secure their place in Euro 96. Chris Armstrong has scored in three of the last four games, and that will have alerted the Arsenal camp, because Armstrong and Sheringham both used to play under Bruce Rioch at Millwall. Rioch is understandably pleased with his present charges. Arsenal field eight England internationals today, including two captains, Adams and Platt, two Dutchmen, Bergkamp and Helder, and one Welshman, who's 20-year-old John Hartson, starting a senior game for the first time this season because Ian Wright begins a three-match suspension. And if the omens do point towards Spurs, then it will be a happy anniversary for Gerry Francis, 1 year in charge today, who's never lost a match to Arsenal in his managerial career. Referee this afternoon, Alan Wilkie from Chesterley Street. So for the 117th time, the two North London rivals meet in league combat. And that was about the right word last year when all sorts went on in these two fixtures. Arsenal beaten only twice this season, playing from the right, there's Tony Adams. And Tottenham beaten only once in their last nine in the league. It's Dizel to Howells. Paul Merson. The players, as much as the supporters, look forward to this fixture. It's the one in North London that nobody wants to lose. Walker was called up to the England squad as a precaution last week, and he'll be up against England's number one this afternoon in the other goal, David Seaman. Helder covers, and a good ball by Hartson to Helder. Glenn Helder has still to score for Arsenal. George Graham's last signing. He was put in here by a lovely touch from young John Hartson. That's Howells. Something could just open up here for Merson. He's got Sol Campbell in front of him. Here's Hartson. It has opened up. In the centre is Bergkamp, and Arsenal take the lead. Well, that did look on from the moment Merson first got the ball. Spurs looked to be a man light somewhere in that defence. And Bergkamp, who they said couldn't score when he first played for Arsenal, now can't stop scoring. Merson plays it in, but watch here, Hartson gives him the return ball. Bergkamp is the third man running. Nobody picks him up. Left foot finish, perfect. Bergkamp stalling at the far post, and who was supposed to be marking him? Well, Tottenham will want to know. Here's Armstrong, trying to thread it through to Sheringham. David Platt. Just a bit hurried. Rosenthal breaking on the left, and this time it was Arsenal's turn to look around and wonder where the defender should have been. Sheringham fires over. That Arsenal are playing the more controlled, cohesive football in this first half. And well played by Fox. Here's Sheringham, free waiting in the centre. Rosenthal comes in. Fox. David Platt got a good foot in there, back by Dean Austin. It's really what Spurs need, a bit of flurry on the edge of the Arsenal area to get them back in the game. It's Fox again. They want the ball in now. Fox with the orthodox winger's cross, and there were plenty of Tottenham players waiting. In fact, Armstrong wasn't very well marked. Says play on, that's exactly what you've got to do. Here's Helder, and Arsenal have got spare men over again. It's Merson. This is how the goal came. Bergkamp. Arsenal loading one side of the field and then releasing Bergkamp. Well, he'll no doubt be playing a part in the playoff match between Holland and Ireland for that one space in the Euro 96 field, but he's certainly moving very smoothly today, Dennis Bergkamp. Oh, good play by Steve Bowe, and then helped on to Helder by Platt. Three waiting in the middle, it's still Helder. Oh, and the Tottenham player who cleared actually did so from on the ground. It's Colin Calderwood. Fell over initially. Played short for Bergkamp. It's Merson again. Gazelle clears. Twice. Two against two here for a moment. If Wilcox could use his pace here, but he's got Winterburn to beat. Armstrong wants it played inside. Sheringham's on the far side. Well, in a week like this, it would have to be Sheringham. Tottenham level just inside the half hour, and Wilcox makes room for the cross. It goes past Armstrong. Sheringham's there. Seaman gets hands to it, but can only help it into the net. Teddy Sheringham, supplied by Rule Fox. And what a few days it's been for this fellow. It's 1-1, and the North London derby is right on the boil. David Howell's well forward in the centre-forward position. Couldn't quite reach that. Oh, well played by David Platt. Now look at this. Merson again. One to his right, two to his left for Arsenal. This is Helder. Danger for Spurs here. And the referee has spotted something that was going on off the ball and wants a word with Chris Armstrong. The word is sufficient, it would seem. And this is the man who's getting hold of the ball for Tottenham now. Will Fox made the goal. What can create here? Armstrong. Good cross as well. Oh, and that was Teddy Sheringham again floating in from the far post position, unmarked. Arsenal seem to have lost track of where Sheringham is. Sheringham. Howells. It's going to come to Fox. Gazelle's in the middle with Armstrong. And Armstrong. And Rosenthal. And Howells. And a deflection. Offside flag is up. Offside flag. Quite a scramble in front of David Seaman there. And again, a cross supplied by Raul Fox from near the line. Armstrong may have shoved Dixon there, I thought, but anyway, play went on, and then it hit David Platt, and finally offside. Well, the North London rivals level at half-time. The Arsenal attack had to be rewritten today because of Ian Wright's absence, but Dennis Bergkamp made light of that when he put the Gunners in front. And the equaliser came from the man who may have rewritten the England team sheet, Teddy Sheringham. So, Arsenal playing left to right in the second half. It's a long time since Tottenham won the First Division Championship. You have to go back to the double year of 1961. That's going to be 35 years this season if they don't win this one. But they were the first team this century to win the double, and Arsenal were the second. In by Armstrong. There was some good movement in the first half. Play flowed from about 15 minutes on pretty continuously. And here's David Howells. Raul Fox's role is quite interesting. He has supplied some good width and some good crosses, but he's also come inside to good effect, as now. There's Dazelle, and it's Fox again. I know that Jerry Francis is very pleased with the effect Fox has had. Bubbly character in the dressing room, and lively on the pitch as well. Bergkamp. Well, nicely done by Lee Dixon. Bergkamp again. Hartson's a long way away, so he's played it to Merson. Now Bergkamp. Still a long way away, Hartson, and that Arsenal attack rather petering out through lack of numbers. Pinpoint ball to Fox. Good trickery by him too, but Adams closing down Sheringham. Now it's David Platt for Arsenal, wanting somebody to go to the right, but there was no one there. It was all a bit narrow really, the Arsenal setup then. This is Armstrong. Sheringham. Armstrong, good position. Very good position. Armstrong, goal! Chris Armstrong. Rather like Bergkamp, he made a slow start with his new club, but he's on fire now. Teddy Sheringham, just appreciation again of space, gets the ball in, and he skips round Steve Bould, and a right foot cross shot beats David Seaman. And very, very composed and deadly there, Chris Armstrong. Four games out of five he scored in now. John Hartson, set for the final ball. Now Dixon. Keown goes in. And the header out only as far as Glenn Heldar. And don't think finishing is the strongest part of his game. But Spurs were struggling a bit here to get the ball away. It wasn't the best of headers from Sol Campbell. Some scenes now in this capacity, 33,000 all-seater crowd. They could have got many more in today, that's for sure. And look at Merson here. Excellent play. And it may work for them. David Platt. So Arsenal now have to do exactly what Tottenham did in the first half. Summon up extra reserves and throw the game back at the opposition. Flat shot. Really anybody's. Glenn Hoddle's struggling with an injury, and as a result of that the attack broke down, and Raul Fox picks the ball up for Tottenham here. Finds Dazelle. Howes coming from midfield. Now to Sheringham. Back in again, first time, David Howes. Oh, and Tony Adams denies Ronnie Rosenthal a certain goal. That very moment, Tottenham could have sealed the game. But look at Adams, he just nicks it from Rosenthal to keep the score at 2-1. It's going to come to Howes. To Armstrong, he's got Dazelle in support as well here. Good ball, Sheringham to Fox. Tottenham moving well. Sheringham, good save by Seaman. Lee Dixon looks around, but there were no Arsenal players marking again. The early ball by Fox, not that early really, to the far post, and Sheringham ghosted in alone. Seaman saved it with his right foot. And that too has just about kept Arsenal in it, but only just. Corner. Played short, David Howes. Good ball in, oh, and that was a chance too. Ronnie Rosenthal, if he'd kept that down. And how many lives are Arsenal going to have here? They're already 2-1 down. And in the last 5 minutes, Spurs have missed three very good chances. None better perhaps than this. He was clear. Well, Bruce Rioch must be wondering quite what's going on in that normally solid Arsenal defence. This stage in the game where one or two Arsenal fans might be wondering if they're missing the cutting edge of Ian Wright. But bearing in mind they had a couple of let-offs, Arsenal will be glad still to be in the fight here. It's Hartson. Oh, that's a good bit of play by Merson. And he couldn't hold it, Walker, and Austin got in. Merson put venom into that. And Walker's first and only responsibility was to keep it out any way he could. This is Dixon. Now Paul Merson coming in from the left, where he's gone since Helder went off. Struck that, but Walker nearly knocked him over, but he was in the right place. Good turn. And that's more direct by Hartson, and forces the corner. Bold is there, so is Keown. Bold is up. Back again to Merson. Adams is coming in. And from this angle, it wasn't easy to see how good a chance that was for Tony Adams, but I suspect it was a let-off for Spurs. It was recrossed by Paul Merson, and as Bergkamp goes up first, well, Adams has got a defender just falling into him. Keown. Winterburn. Oh, it's set up here for Bergkamp. Nicely laid off to him there by John Hartson. Straight at the goalkeeper. Dixon. There goes Bergkamp. It's too long. Spurs, who beat Arsenal here 1-0 last season in Jerry Francis' first North London derby, are now on the edge of repeating that victory. In fact, they've done so, this time 2-1. He's still unbeaten against the Arsenal as a manager. Bruce Rioch, his third defeat of the season. Teddy Sheringham, another immaculate performance for Tottenham. Made the second goal, having scored the first. Armstrong got the winner. Merson was outstanding for Arsenal. But today, it's Tottenham who come out of the North London derby on top. An edge a little nearer to Arsenal in the Premiership table. What a week for Teddy Sheringham.
They're a very good side and a very good unit, and they don't concede many goals. But today, other than the first 15-minute spell where I thought they played very well, Arsenal, we gave them far too much room and got their goal. We sorted that out a lot better at half-time, and throughout the game we really created chances. And if I'm disappointed about anything, it was that we didn't take more of the chances.
And you've had a lot of possession in the game, as we had early on. You sometimes forget how you get the ball. And it came natural for us to have all that possession for 20, 25 minutes. Second half, when we needed to just battle a little bit harder to regain it, we probably didn't do that as well as a unit, and consequently they got the second goal, and then we started coming a bit stronger at the end, but disappointing for us.
You waited quite a long time to get off the market, Tottenham. Was that just a question of a settling in process?
Yeah, I think so. It is hard, I think, when you come to a club like this, you know, the size of Tottenham, and I did struggle towards the start to find the back of the net, but you know, hopefully now I'm on the right track.
You must have been pleased with that one, made by Teddy Sheringham.
Yeah, I was all pleased. You know, obviously, I know how big this game is to all the fans here. It's all I've heard since I've come here, is, you know, they want us to win this game, and, you know, so I'm more than delighted to have got the winner.
All the boys are saying they're going to go out and celebrate tonight, and I'll be no different. I'll be going out to suss out who the Arsenal supporters are and have a little cheeky grin at them.
Don't blame him. It's been a dual fixture over the years quite often, but not today. It was quite exhilarating.
It was an excellent game. I mean, first 25 minutes, Arsenal passed as well as I've seen it for a good while. You could see the influence of Bruce Rioch. He likes his side to do that, play out from the back. They got ahead and looked at that stage. I thought they might get two or three. And then, you know, Spurs got their equaliser. And I think, you know, Armstrong is settling down. Teddy Sheringham, you know, adds that little bit of guile. Armstrong gives a little bit of pace. But I think possibly, you know, Fox gave him the width. I mean, we've got to remember they're without Klinsmann. Anderson's been missing. But here, I mean, you know, we ring Sharon on the edge of the penalty area. Little cushion header there. And it enables Spurs to break out then. Armstrong and Fox gets it out wide. And while all this is happening, Teddy Sheringham has made up all the ground from his own edge of his penalty area defending. And his second header is the one that actually gives the equaliser and puts it into the back of the net. David Seaman unlucky because he did get his body across very well, but they are an excellent counter-attacking side, and a lot of it is here. You know, it comes off the back to Teddy Sheringham. six Arsenal players. No one's picking him up, and he just finds that space between the midfield and the back four and spreads the play now, because he's got the wide man that has been missing when Anderson's sort of been out of the side for so many matches. And then again, Gary Mabbutt, good win. I love to see central defenders then in that situation going forward. Gives it to Armstrong, carries on and occupies the back then of Arsenal, who picks it up deep again, Sheringham. Good feet there for Armstrong, and tucked away the shot very well into the corner. But that little trio broke exceptionally well, and it is always Sheringham finding space, linking up the game with Armstrong and spreading the play. Now he has got that target. A lot went down that right hand side. Who of course comes in late and heads it down, and look at the right foot of Seaman here. Does very well, because it was going in the near post. But all the time they've got that right flank. Yeah, Armstrong likes to go use that pace down the right. They were a little bit lopsided at some stage. When Anderson comes back, will he play centre or left? I don't know, but they certainly shouldn't move Fox from the right.
Arsenal were good to watch too in long spells for that match. I got the feeling though, I wonder if under George Graham they'd have hung on to that 1-0.
Well, they've only given six goals away before today's game. I mean, they were a bit vulnerable when they were chasing the game. I still think they lack a little bit of creativeness in midfield. Glenn Helder's a little bit inconsistent down the left, especially his shooting and his final ball. So they're two or three players away, I think, from challenging for the championship. But much
they're London's only hope for the championship,
yeah,
aren't
definitely,
they?
Yeah, definitely, at this stage already.
All right. Thanks very much. Well, the last time that Everton had beaten Liverpool at Anfield in the league was 10 years ago. Mr. Lineker, incidentally, was one of the scorers then. Today, Liverpool were out to underline their title ambitions. It was another untypical derby game. Commentary from Clive Tilson.
Anfield packed to the rafters for Derby Day. This, of course, will be the setting for the last act of the European Championship qualifiers next month, the playoff between Holland and the Republic of Ireland. There were three Liverpool men in Jack Charlton's reprieved team on Wednesday. Jason McAteer thought he'd be returning from Portugal to sit on the Anfield substitutes bench today, but an international injury to Jamie Redknapp has handed him a starting spot in his favourite spot in midfield. Four of today's team returned from national service, including the only two Liverpool-born players there, Steve McManaman and Robbie Fowler, both of whom were boyhood Everton fans. Something went wrong with the Goodison scouting network there. Two Everton men represented their countries in the week. Neville Southall, who's played in more of these derbies than anyone ever, and Andrei Kanchelskis, who was in action against Finland, a match Joe Royle travelled to Russia to watch. He's made a bold selection today, with Kanchelskis on one wing and Anders Limpar on the other. Mind you, both have combined in all three Everton League victories thus far, so Royle just couldn't resist the gamble, even at Anfield. Gerald Ashby is the only neutral for miles around, and with 40,000 scouters gathered in earshot, he certainly won't be short of advice during the afternoon, will he? As ever on Merseyside, it's a local derby with national repercussions, third of the way into the season. Everton just 4 points clear of the relegation zone, closer than they'd want to be, certainly. Liverpool already 11 points adrift of the leaders, not close enough for their liking. Gary Ablett, the former Liverpool player, intercepted by Jason McAteer, a lifelong Liverpool fan. Ian Rush, Rob Jones, probably the greatest irony of all, that Ian Rush, the record goal scorer in Merseyside derbies, was himself a boyhood Everton fan. Barnes to McManaman, nicely done for McAteer. Jones. McManaman's flick, Fowler. To start, Rush, won by Liverpool, no! Linesman's flags up, it won't count. Ian Rush celebrates in front of the car, but there's some bad news coming his way. And Ian Rush's goal is almost part and parcel of Derby Day on Merseyside. He's tortured Everton down the years, but he was in an offside position in the opinion of the linesman on the near side. Peter Walton's flag was raised immediately. Kulusevski is on his way, and Limpar's followed him. And what a pass that is. Right out of something support. Stewart straining to get there. Andre Kulusevski. Saved by James, cleared by Jones. And Liverpool got away with it. Rob Jones is rather panicky clearance, almost put them back in trouble. McAteer. Parkinson getting back there. Well played by Mark Wright. Typical of his form this season. Rush. A year ago, Wright's attitude was being questioned, and he was nursing an Achilles problem. There seemed to be no way back for him at Liverpool. Fowler. What will he do next? He'll find Rush, and he'll turn, and Southall will say. McManaman was beautifully placed next to Ian Rush. Very staunch Everton rearguard present. Protected by a very industrious midfield. It's not to say the visitors haven't had their moments in front of goal too. But Manaman was just held there, but he's got possession. McManaman decided to take matters into his own hands. One or two players on the field today who are so exciting when they're running with the ball. McAteer. That's where Barnes wanted the ball to go in the first place. Hartness. Barnes to Fowler. Hartness. Fowler. McManaman. Nicely conceived attack. Steve McManaman. Ooh, and almost caught Southall by surprise, but you can't help but think that a ball pulled back across the face of goal would have been more productive. Jackson. Stewart. Limpar just inside of him. Kulusevski's wide to the right. Graham Stewart. Curled it. Oh, hit the post. And David James is a lucky, lucky lad. Terrific effort by Graham Stewart. Always seemed to be setting himself for that. And it just wouldn't come back enough for him. And David James, who didn't quite know where it was, found it in the nick of time. Everton had to make do with the corner. Schwartz there. Come through for Unsworth. Disappointing outcome to a very promising Everton attack. It was a half which set off at a pace and almost finished with a bang. Graham Stewart's shot striking the post, the man who scored Everton's only two goals in their last five games. Rush, who always seems to score against Everton, denied by a linesman's flag early on. It's 0-0. Liverpool's home record this season has a familiarly daunting ring about it. Bolton Wanderers are the only visitors to have scored at Anfield in the Premiership. Five wins, one draw and no defeats to date. Gary Lineker was a scorer when Everton last took maximum points here. Yes, it was that long ago, 1986. Actually, everybody involved with Liverpool will tell you he was offside that day. Alan Hansen had his arm up again. Kulusevski's ride out. Kulusevski's! Yes! Andrei Kulusevski's has scored his first goal for Everton. And he scored it against Liverpool at the top end. I should think that's pretty much the way he dreamt it last night.
Kanchelskis is supposed to provide the crosses for Rideout, but it was the other way around, and both of them performed their tasks superbly. Terrific centre, and a really well-timed header by Andre Kanchelskis. Watson's header has fallen for Harkness. Signs of frustration amongst the Liverpool fans. Barnes. They should be well used to seeing teams in red pass the ball patiently and try and wait their moment. That's certainly what this team is trying to do. And everybody who supports them is getting a little anxious about it now. We're into the final quarter of the match. McAteer. Ebril. Limpar. Scott Stewart and Kanchelskis ahead of him. Andre Kanchelskis. Oh, 2-0! It's Andre's day. Everton lead by 2-0 and Kanchelskis has got them both. Some derby debut. Limpar played him in, and the shot from Kanchelskis just carried too much power for David James to keep it out. Power packed, and just in the area where it's difficult for a goalkeeper, down by his knees, down by his shins. Matt Manaman. Free kick's been given. Barnes is the master of ceremonies. Wright is up there, so too is Scales. Harkness is waiting here. Steve Harkness. Header from David Unsworth. I bet he felt that. Thundering shot from the Liverpool fullback, and number four, Unsworth, was brave enough to put his head in the way. Scales, headed from Barnes, and then from Roche Southall's there. Just about in the hands of the Everton keeper, oh dear. Well, the ball was loose. Neville Southall hanging on for dear life down there. I think it was Ian Rush, his good pal, who went in. And it was all a bit of nonsense, to be honest. Rush and Southall were there. And there's Rush going in. Well, those two are coaches together with the Welsh national team. Mark Wright got a piece of it. Everybody got very excited. Everybody apart from Southall, who was the injured party. Thomas back there. And then Wright. Dave Watson not standing on ceremony. Just a flicker of a smile on the face of Joe Royle behind Jimmy Gabriel then. Smile which will widen as the night goes on, I suspect. Scales. Came off the head of Short. Manaman trying to get there, and did, away by Short as far as Fowler, and that's found a way through, and this isn't quite over yet. Robbie Fowler reviving Liverpool hopes with 90 seconds remaining on the watch. And for all the bodies that Everton had back there, they couldn't prevent Fowler's daisy cutter finding its way through. Manaman had the first go, that was cleared by Short. three pairs of legs, I think. 2-1. Rob Jones. Huge roar going up from the cop behind David James. He was a little psychological victory that Everton won right at the start of the afternoon by winning the toss and making Liverpool attack the Kop End in the first half. Barnes almost played it into the path of Rush. Matt Manaman. Ruddock the substitute, looking for Fowler, finding only Watson. Barnes, on by McAteer this time. Scales. And again, only for Parkinson, now ride out. Not much time for Liverpool. This is the time that Gerald Ashby has added on. They can only be so patient now. Wright getting it forward. Short getting it away. Stewart trying to lay claim to it. On by Rydout. Kanchelskis. Stewart. He's onside here. Stopped by James. Liverpool's hopes are hanging by a thread, but they are still hanging. No, they're not. It's over. Blue is the colour of Merseyside tonight. Everton's first success at Anfield for 8 years. Spearheaded by two goals from Andrei Kanchelskis. Three straight defeats for Liverpool now. Damaging defeats to their high hopes for a return to the good old days. It's a good old day for Everton, whose season turned on a derby win a year ago in Joe Royle's first match in charge, and may just be turning again. They'll enjoy tonight 2-1 winners at Anfield.
What was the game plan?
To get behind the ball, to try and frustrate them a little bit, to make sure that when they got the ball in midfield we had plenty of bodies around them, and then try and hit them on the break.
They are so patient, aren't they? So determined to play it their way, and you made it difficult for them to do that.
Well, we did, and obviously we didn't come here to lie down. We had a game plan, and as you say, it's worked. But we now have the pace with the two wide men in the side to hit sides on the break. So, you know, we're getting stronger all the time, and I thought against Blackburn last week there were good signs being carried on today.
We felt we played a lot of football, but then David got nothing from it, and done exactly the same against Newcastle, the same result. So I believe, you know, sometimes that you've got to play the long ball. I think Everton done it twice and they got two goals from it. I don't believe they had many attacks, but saying that, you know, they've got 3 points and we haven't. So sometimes you've got to change your game. You know, when we play teams like Everton, you know, they battle hard and they kick a long ball, and sometimes you've got to do the same as them.
It's a great result. Lots very good play. Every last very good play today. Good results, 3 points, yeah. I'm happy. It's my team win today. Very happy, yeah.
From a morale point of view, it probably means more to the players, does it, than any other kind of victory?
Well, I think so. I mean, I watched Dave Watson's face change. He's got one of those smiles that you're going to need an operation to get rid of at the moment.
It's a bit like the Spurs-Arsenal match, in fact, because sometimes that's a very dour game, yeah, too, and it wasn't today. It was nice open.
Usually these games are tight, but I thought today, lots of open football, lots of chances, good entertainment. First 25 minutes, I thought Liverpool were going to cruise it, but credit to Everton, they came back into the game and probably just deserved to win it. Mm. Everton are a decent team. I think they're in a false position. They've got a great mixture of grit and determination with a couple of good players that, on their day, if they turn it on, they'll give anybody problems.
Mm. Joe Royle mentioned the wide players that they've got now, and Kanchelskis had a super day.
Yeah, well, if you're defending deep and hitting the break, pace is a tremendous asset. We saw him play for Manchester United. When it breaks down here, here's another player, Limpar. This pass is absolutely frightening. But it's all about the pace of Kanchelskis. He's up against Babb, who's no slouch, but the ball's playing in front of him. Babb goes back in his heels. He takes a great save from the keeper for Liverpool not to go 1-0 down. And as I say, if you're defending deep and you're going to hit in the break, just play the ball anywhere in front of him, and he's a great outlet for them.
Now, what about Liverpool? What's happening to them at the moment? They've had 3 defeats in a row, but they're passing the ball around nicely. And
I didn't think they played so well today. They still passed it quite nicely, but I think the Liverpool secret over the years has been that when you've got the ball, you work hard, but when you haven't got it, you work even harder. The team that was working hard today when they didn't have the ball was Everton, to be fair. And here's an example. Babb comes forward, gets caught. And Everton hitting the break, and Kinsella's again on the right hand side, but there really isn't a challenge here. It's a great ball across the box, but he just got too far in front of everybody. Again, Babs on the ball, nice pass here by Liverpool, but Everton worked hard, they've got it back, and now they're hitting on the break. And you've got to ask yourself, where are the Liverpool challenges coming in here? There's plenty of red jerseys back there. Decent ball in, but the marking is non-existent. And Everton, it's a good header. But the second goal for me summed it up. Limpar goes to Jones, closes him down quickly, doesn't let him pass. Then it comes to Barnes, Stewart closes him down quickly, makes it very difficult. When it's played through to McAteer, Ebro gets in quickly. And then when Unsworth eventually gets his foot in, the ball ends up in the Liverpool net and there's no challenge whatsoever. Limpar here skips past two, skips past another two.
That's wide, isn't it?
Wide open space into Kinsella's and bottom corner.
But Limpar's run there was sheer ability, wasn't it? It wasn't anything to do with bad defending, was it?
I think you must have been a left winger in a former life.
Very harsh on Anders there.
Very hard. It was a good play, wasn't it, Trent?
Well, I thought
great,
so.
Great attack. Yeah. Well, the last English survivors in Europe, and unbeaten in the Premiership over 25 games, some record by Nottingham Forest, but records, of course, are there to be broken, and this one was smashed to pieces.
A fitting scoreline for Rovers on the official opening of the rebuilt Ewood Park. The club that Jack built saw the chairman, Jack Walker, lead the team onto the pitch. Nottingham Forest began to ship goals in the 20th minute. Ripley's cross was flicked on by Newell, and Alan Shearer scored the first of his three. 8 minutes later, Blackburn Rovers moved two in front. Lars Buchanan, who didn't have the friendliest of receptions from the visiting Forest fans, scored a cracker against his former club. In the second half, Blackburn turned the screw and were seemingly able to score at will. Alan Shearer added his second in the 57th minute. Forrest then hit further problems when Steve Chettle was ordered off for his rash challenge on Shearer, Chettle's second bookable offence. And then to add insult to injury from the subsequent free kick, Alan Shearer completed his hat-trick, Blackburn 4 in front. Shearer was at the heart of everything, and when Forrest failed to clear his free kick, time for a Bohemian Rhapsody. 8 minutes to go, two goals to come, and once again Alan Shearer, a key player, he set up Mike Newell this time. And with a minute remaining, Blackburn scored a seventh, the best of the afternoon from Graham Lasso. A great day for Blackburn and for Alan Shearer.
Well, if we can perform like that week in, week out, and especially away from home, then we'll be all right. But it's our away form that's been a problem. And we've been playing something like that against Chelsea at home and at Southampton at home, and perhaps should have scored more goals then. But everyone in the stadium today has been lucky enough to see a vintage performance, and the seven goals are a big, big bonus.
The run has come to an end in rather spectacular fashion.
Yeah, it's come to an end with a bang, really. I mean, I'm not worried about that. I'm not concerned about the run coming to an end, obviously. It was a very disappointing day for us. Disappointing day all round, you know, it went wrong from the start and got worse as the game went on.
And that was a sentiment echoed by Southampton. Poor Southampton didn't know what hit them. 3.5 minutes later, Giggs breaks clear again. The end product this time hallmarked by pure class. Later rivals would have missed United's third as well. Cantona's lovely flick on. This time Paul Scholes couldn't believe the space he had. The clock showed 8 minutes. United's fourth in the second half, David Beckham's corner, and only Andy Cole's third goal of the season. His relief quite evident. As a contest, it was over, but Dave Merrington's side showed much more spirit in the second half and caught United relaxing. Neil Shipley giving the Saints something on a day they lost their halos because of that wretched start.
But the Forest defeat was difficult to fathom today.
Well, when you're on a run like that, when you've gone 20-odd matches undefeated, you sometimes go on the pitch and you think, can't get beaten here. You start badly, you fall away. The secret is bounce back the next game. The next game's Tuesday night. We shall be there and we'll be looking forward to them bouncing back.
Well, Blackburn, of course, had a Forest old boy helping there today.
Well, I think, I mean, we saw Blackburn, what, 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I thought they were a little bit unbalanced there. But Bohanan in midfield, I think, added a little bit of variety and subtlety, which they've lacked in Europe. And, you know, his probing, I think, is actually still batty on the left-hand side, looks a bit lopsided. Lasso coming back helped there, but, you know, they're on the up, whereas Forest need to recharge the batteries before Tuesday.
I do. And of course, as they say, we are at the City Ground on Tuesday night for Forest in Europe against Lyon in the UEFA Cup. We just hope they were saving themselves today. Well, now it's to Villa Park. Their visitors, top of the table, Newcastle United. John Champion was there.
Charles with the free kick. York. Back to Charles. Any number of players waiting. Milosevic's header. Hislop's acrobatic stop. But that sweeping Villa move so nearly brought a classic goal, with Milosevic still looking for his first goal at Villa Park, just a fingertip away. Beardsley. Gillespie. Beardsley loping forward in the centre. Ferdinand by the penalty spot. Barton. Now Beardsley. Back to Barton. This is better play. Aimed towards Ginola, who thought about a shot. Ferdinand took it off him. Ferdinand shoots. And Ferdinand, for once this season, puts it wide. Well, he scored goals aplenty this season from chances just like that. Ginola thought he might have had a shooting chance. Ferdinand said, no, that's mine. And promptly scraped the post. McGrath. And now Gary Charles. Draper wants it. And Draper gets it. Away from Beresford. Away from Ginola. Here's the cross. Aimed towards Johnson with the heading chance. Hislop can't keep it out, can he? The referee looks to the linesman and says goal. And no wonder Tommy Johnson is delighted. Because as a boy, black and white blood coursed through his every vein. He was the most ardent of Newcastle supporters. And now he's scored against them. Draper always a danger. What a good header, and Peacock's efforts on the line were in vain. Draper is such a danger when just on the edge of the penalty area. Johnson hasn't started many games this season. This one he's made a real mark on. 1-0 to Villa. Draper. Johnson is onside. Hislop comes out and acts as a sweeper. And he can be fairly proud of that piece of defensive work, Shaka Hislop. Johnson retreating. The flag stays down. Here's Dwight York. Milosevic wants the cross. He tries a shot. And that wasn't too far away from the frame of the goal either. Well, for once this season, Messrs McDermott, McMenemy and Keegan on the left have substantial food for thought. Southgate played long for York. Oh, good header in field. Johnson struck it well. Hislop could only parry, and Milosevic was nearly in. Johnson's having a rare old time of it. Gillespie. Barton outside. Ferdinand by the penalty spot. Beardsley and Barton. Usually that combination is so potent. This time it's back with Gillespie. Twisting, turning, crossing. Southgate missed. Here's Ginola. Oh, he struck it well. And that's as close as Newcastle have come this afternoon to an equalising goal. It's Gillespie who created the chance. Southgate at full stretch couldn't quite get it away. And Ginola struck it powerfully. And not far off target. Johnson, who spent much of the first half on the left-hand side. Now he's very much on the right. Giving Newcastle plenty to think about. Charles. York in the middle, it's over him, not over Milosevic. He couldn't take it quite in his stride. Ferdinand goes all the way through, past the keeper, classic striker's goal. Scored by the classic striker. A long, long ball downfield. Villa perhaps caught napping slightly. Despairing challenge by the defender. Super finish by Ferdinand. Ehiog seemed to be with him. Still he was with him, then suddenly he wasn't. And a man deemed only good enough for the England bench is very much the Premiership's top scorer at the moment. Les Ferdinand, 1-1. Really desperate defending at times from Villa now. They may be required to do some more. Barton. Beardsley. Ferdinand thinks just momentarily about a shot. Beardsley again. He can be so dangerous with the ball at his feet. Lovely reverse pass. Ferdinand.
Barton, great save. Well, it was lovely build-up by Newcastle. The broad chest of Ferdinand proved to be productive after Beardsley had done his usual impish stuff. Ferdinand laid it on. Barton struck it well. The save was equal to it.
When you look at it, they had the better of the first half. We had to pull our socks up a bit. Gaffer went in at half time and gives a bit of a roller kick. And we came out, and I think we deservedly took a point here.
Was it the first real rollicking you've had of the season?
Yeah, I think we had one at Southampton and again today. But, you know, we knew it was below par in the first half and we needed to step our game up.
Second half, they showed some grit and determination that obviously their manager would be looking at. You know, when you come away from home and you get a draw, I suppose that it's a good result.
You wanted to make a point about that Newcastle point.
I thought it was a good result for them today. They didn't play well against Liverpool, apparently didn't play that well against Blackburn, and didn't play that well today. But 7 points out of nine, when they start playing well, the rest will take a bit of catching.
Right. Now, 3 weeks tomorrow, we have our annual Bash, Sports Review of the Year. Who will be this year's top personality? Just some of the candidates for Sports Personality of the Year. If you wish to vote, this is how. Send us a postcard with your choice on it and your name and your address. Just pick one name and you'll find out 3 weeks on Sunday who's won it. Good programme for you that evening. We hope you'll be able to join us. Right, back to the football now. Four more games to catch up on, starting with Leeds United, home to Chelsea.
Leeds United were hoping to play record signing Thomas Brolin, but the Swedish player's registration hadn't come through and he had to watch. Chelsea appeared to be heading for at least a point, but 10 minutes from time, Tony Yeboah popped up to score his first goal in 9 matches. The Chelsea manager Glenn Hoddle claimed the goal shouldn't have counted. He says goalkeeper Dimitri Karin was fouled by Brian Deane, allowing Yeboah to take his chance. But the goal stood, points to Leeds.
Sheffield Wednesday fans have forgotten what it's like to win at home, but after 14 minutes, the omens look good for them. Keith Curl gave Mark de Greeser too much care and attention. The penalty award seemed understandable. David Hurst's emphatic strike made it difficult again for Manchester City, whose away points tally up to date was certainly consistent. None. But Alan Ball's team are beginning to fight, and when Niall Quinn's measured cross found Steve Lomas, their first point was greeted with some justified celebration. City are throwing out hints that their dark days may be coming to an end.
Well, we've dug a hole for ourselves, but, you know, nothing's impossible. If we keep playing like that and believing in ourselves, it won't be long before we're winning games and things are going okay.
Restless Bolton fans protested afterwards about the club's precarious position. They remain dangerously close to the bottom after today's 3-0 defeat. The deadlock was broken a minute into the second half with a thumping strike from Ian Bishop. Bolton were then reduced to 10 men when captain Mark Patterson was ordered off for his challenge on Bishop, his second bookable offence in 4 minutes. As Bolton tried to reorganise, West Ham went two in front, Tony Cotty putting them in the driving seat and on the way to 3 precious points. And then with a minute to go in the game already won, West Ham added a third. Danny Williamson ran from deep inside his own half to score. Tough times ahead for Bolton Wanderers.
Worst thing that can happen now is that the players lose confidence and they fear in terms of playing football, and that's something we've got to try and get out of their system and their minds, because it's important that players, when they go on that football field, when they cross that white line, that they express the ability that they have.
With 7 successive Premiership defeats to contend with, Wimbledon were determined to end the run against Middlesbrough, but the best chance in a dour match fell to Borough's Janaga Fjortoft. He hit the post, the draw a fair scoreline.
Harry Gratian and Gary Richardson with those stories. The table tonight, Newcastle lead the Premiership by 6 points. Second place Manchester United can reduce the gap in midweek when they play their game in hand at Coventry. Despite losing, have moved up one place to third. That's because Nottingham Forest dropped three after their 7-0 drubbing at Blackburn. Aston Villa and Leeds are now fourth and fifth respectively, with Liverpool seventh. At the other end, Manchester City remain bottom despite collecting their first away point of the season. Bolton's home defeat by West Ham leaves them in trouble. QPR play Coventry tomorrow. Well, there we are, that's it. We hope to see you Tuesday night for Nottingham Forest against Lyon, but for now it's good night from us, and it's good night from him.
Violent assault.
The soldier has actually got a severe cut all the way through his lip.
A domestic incident.
He's grabbed her by the hair and smashed her head off the doorframe and then beat her up and then threw her out in the grass.
A home arrest.
So to get something on. Because you're under arrest.
What's devastating for some is just another day's work for the Royal Military Police. Red Caps. This Thursday, 10:20, on BBC One.
A strange journey into the American Deep South on BBC Two in 25 minutes as Jill Clayburgh goes in search of long-lost relatives. Barbara Hershey co-stars in the film drama Shy People.
Over on BBC Two, hello, 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 meet Gareth Cheeseman.
How about him?
How about a salesman?
You're number one. You're a tiger!
With conviction.
Roar!
Okay.
Contact.
Bye, Mum. Bye.
And clip nose hairs. Dearth of a Salesman. Coogan's Run. Friday at 9:30 over on BBC Two.
Ow!
George Peppard stars in the late film here on BBC One in 30 minutes. A spaghetti western adventure set in revolutionary Mexico. Cannon for Cordoba. Before that, it's time to take a seat for the stand-up show.
Let's get rolling.
Let's have a nice round of applause.
I've got some good news and some bad news.
One, two, one, two.
Ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Welcome to the Stand Up Show. What a week. I went to the doctor a couple of days ago and I walked in. He said, sit down, pull up a chair. And I said, do you mind if I do it the other way round? So he said, what's the problem? Why have you come to see me? I said, I'm unfit. He said, when did you last take exercise? I said, I don't know. Ask the midwife. So I gave him a sample. It had a good head on it. And then he asked for a pint of blood, and it came back with keg marked on it with a request for dry roasted peanuts. And he said, the way you're going, you'll be lucky to see 90. And I said, I'm not frightened of dying. Have you seen my act? Anyway, on with the show. Our first act is Busy Busy, going all around the country. He's the star of Channel 4's One for the Road, the man of whom Julian Clary said, if you see him close up, he's got a lovely complexion. We've got a chance to see it. Welcome, Alan Davies!
Thank you very much. Good evening.
Good evening.
Cool. You're all alive then, smashing. What was I going to talk to you about? I was going to talk to you about the first time I ever asked a girl out, actually, because I thought it was quite funny. Although it wasn't meant to be at the time. It was a girl called Lisa. I was about 13 at the time. It took me ages to ask her out. I kept going up to her in the playground like this. I go up to her and go, Lisa, hi. Lisa, all right? Lisa, hi. Yeah, it's me. Hi. Do you want to go to the Paul Disco with me on Saturday? And she turned around to all her mates and went... And then one of her mates came out and went, yeah, she will. So I went back and told my dad. I said, I've asked this girl out. I didn't mention Graham in the third year that I quite fancied. I went straight in. And he looked quite excited, and he said to me straight away, he said, right, now there are some things you must know if you're going out with ladies. I thought, well, right, steady, first date, but, you know, we'll plough straight in. He said, sit down. Now, if you're going upstairs, it's very important that you should walk behind the lady in case she should fall, and then you'll be able to catch her. Now, I didn't know anything about girls, but couldn't get up and down stairs? That was news to me. As if you're ever going to catch anyone who's hurtling down a flight of stairs. As if you're not going to go, cool, how do you get away, Billy? Same thing, apparently, when you're going downstairs, you've got to be in front of her, because at any minute she'll come crashing down. And you'll have to brace yourself, and she'll become wedged against your manly back. And you pick her up, take her in the discotheque. When you're out on the street, now he emphasised this, it's very important. When you're out on the street, you must walk on the curb side. You must walk between the lady and the traffic. In case a car swerving out of control should mount the pavement and come hurtling towards you, whereupon you must step in front of her and deflect it aside. All the time, keep your eye on her, bound to be fainting, chuck out an arm, grab her, move her to safety, here's a bus, don't panic, I got it. I don't know where all that came from. That came from olden times, when there were no sewers, and there were all feces in the gutter. People just used to lob buckets out of windows, and it would lie there, and if a stagecoach went past, whoosh, all over you. So the bloke used to walk on the outside, and he'd wear a long coat, it would be all velvet or velour on the inside. The lady, and then rotting, dripping oil skin. And they'd step out for the evening like that. Are you looking forward to this evening?
I am.
They used to have to walk backwards all the way home. Do you enjoy yourself? I do. The rest of it will come from some book of etiquette, some 19th century book of girlfriend disasters. You can find these books of how to behave in the second-hand bookshops. They're fantastic. Some bloke will have had a series of disasters and set it all down on paper. His first girlfriend, he was following her down the stairs like a fool. Inevitably, she tripped and fell and smashed her head on every stone step all the way down to the bottom, lay there hemorrhaging violently in front of the whole family on lots of those mornings. Second girlfriend, he didn't open the door for her. She carried on walking, never opened the door on a knife, didn't know you had to. And I must set this down for my fellow man. What a disaster. Got passed on to me, 1978. I'm going to the school disco. And I'm behind Lisa on the stairs. Fully expecting at any minute she'll come crashing down. She looks around, what's the matter with you? Ah, I thought you were coming. Keep going, we're nearly there. We get to the top of the stairs, she's made it. There's a door, I've got to get round in front of her. Wait, open the door. She goes through the door, there are stairs going down on the other side of it. There's no sign, there's no warning. She's just walking boldly towards them, not a thought for her own safety. I thought she had to rugby tackle her to one side. I said, for God's sake, there's a flight of stairs there. What's the matter with you, trying to kill yourself? Allow me. All the way down, checking. Listen out for that telltale, yeah, and she'll come crashing down. We get to the bottom of the stairs, there's so much to remember, I've just got an estate, I can't remember what I'm doing, we've gone the wrong way, we're lost, we're in some basement, I open a door, I've let her out on the street. What a disaster. We've all seen girls drifting about in the traffic, unattended. And Lisa, for God's sake, I can hear a stagecoach. Ran out in the middle of the road. Ah! end of date. She was back upstairs dancing with Graham. I didn't get either of them. So I live on my own now, obviously. May or may not be connected, I'm not sure. I don't mind living on my own. Sometimes when you live on your own, you get anything. Oh, there's no one here. Sometimes you think, yeah, hey, no one here. Do what bloody you like. Have a bath, the door open, go mad.